welcome you all to this event. It's one of the UNPOP series. And as you know, UNPOP tries to explore and navigate the articulation between populism, emotions, and politics, and is coordinated by Cristiano Gianella, who is over there taking pictures. And today we have the privilege to have with us Manuela Cagliani. Manuela is an associate professor in political science in the Scuola Normale Superiore, affiliated scholar at the Cosmos Center for Social Movement Studies, and associated faculty at the Institute for Advanced Studies in Vienna. She's a well-known scholar and has published widely in the areas of social movements, far-right politics, and extremism online. She is now the PI of two highly relevant projects, one on H2020 on neo-authoritarianisms in Europe and the liberal democratic response, and another one on democratic challenges, social sustainability, and gender inequalities. And she will be presenting here today, or talking to you in a more informal way, she will let you know, on the dark side of the web, extreme right organizations, and the internet in Europe and the USA. And with no further ado, please welcome Professor Manuela Cagliani.
Thank you. Thank you very much for this kind introduction. And it is a pleasure to be here. I actually never been in Coimbra, so this invitation has been particularly grateful because I never been. And it has been a pleasure to be invited by this group within the context of the UNIPOP project, which seems to me a really, really important project. Exactly for this being in between academia and outside. You know, I appreciate that a lot. And in my view, they are doing a really great job also in organizing events like this one. So, to be honest, it's a quite novelty also for me. Usually I'm much more used to talking in front of university people with their slides in which I present all my graph. But I will try to do of my best. So let's put it as a sort of conversation, more than me giving you some data, also because it is difficult to talk about data without showing them. So what I can do is to introduce to you, as I did more or less this morning, the idea. So what I'm doing this in my research. Now it's almost 15 years that I studied the radical right. Not the extreme right, the radical right, the right-wing extremism. And when I started, no, I stand up because I prefer. When I started to study the radical right, actually, I was in Vienna at that time, I was an assistant professor. The radical right, political science, was only studied from what we call a party politics approach. So party politics and elections. Like the radical right was existing only in this electoral arena. And then it's true, of course, then the following years also did teach us that many radical right-wing parties are increasing their electoral success, so they are also reaching very important parliamentary and even governmental positions. So on the one hand, it is good to look at the radical right from the perspective of elections, voters and political parties. However, when I started to focus on the radical right, I was coming from a social movement perspective. So I was born as a social movement scholar, focusing on the usual suspects in social movements like environmentalist movements, so left-wing progressive ones. But this perspective, actually, the social movement perspective on these kind of topics, actually also bring about a peculiar view on this phenomena, a view which pays into account the, for instance, ideas, cultural means of communication, the understanding of political participation of citizens also in between elections. So what does it mean, political participation? It also means, for instance, becoming politically active on the web, or building a website through which some ideas are diffused, recruitment is done, and so on and so forth. So this is the background. I am a political scientist, this is a premise, I am a political scientist,
very often working in between quantitative data and qualitative research. So also in my research, usually when I study the extreme right, I apply methods of social research that usually qualitative scholars use, like ethnography, focus groups, interviews. So it also happens to me to be very close to this kind of, to these groups and to these activists, which is also a challenge. No? So this topic, this can be the first topic allowed, which is about the positionality of the researcher. So we as researcher, in principle, we should be neutral, not study our object of research in a neutral way. Also, I want to add, in principle, we should put ourselves in the shoes of the others when we study them. So when I study political violence, my interest is to understand when and why political violence does become legitimate for people. So why people decide that political violence or extremism is a legitimate form of political action. So in order to do that, I also have to abandon my assumptions, what I feel good or bad, no? So my also normative values. And this, of course, poses some problems as a researcher. So this is the first also provocation or question I raise here. So is it possible to do neutral social science research? So for instance, as a left-wing militant, could you really analyze and understand that some phenomena without some assumptions, without some normative values behind, or the opposite, as a conservative anti-gender person? Can you really approach, for instance, squatted center and understand why they occupy buildings and they, in this way, they perform some political action? This is the first idea or provocation I launch. But let's go back to the content of my research. So here, what I would like to talk about is the dark side of the web. So what is the dark side of the web? Usually, when we think about the internet and when, let me say, more or less 15, 20 years ago, there has been in this wedding between political science and media studies, no? So this idea that communication studies and political science could interact with each other, because actually internet was exploding, and internet was exploding 20, 25 years ago, also as a means for people to politically participate more actively. So for political participation, for organizing collective action, for organizing groups. And also everyone might remind the anti-globalization protests from Seattle in the following years. They have been organized also due to the web. Before, it would have been impossible to create such a global movement without the help of the internet. And therefore, at the beginning, and here also some assumptions that we as researchers probably have to break, you know, in order to make our view more clear. Internet has been seen at the beginning as a powerful tool for democracy. Democracy, universalism, the construction of a global village, so all positive, very positive things, also in terms of quality of democracy. Because of course it was empowering people, also disintermediating. And we use very often this word in sociology, disintermediation. It means that each of us can create a party or a website and a movement. And before the web, before the internet, it would have been much, much more difficult to mobilize people. However, what happened is that slowly, but not so slowly, but we realized, so something that today is quite intuitive, but 20 years ago a bit less, we realized that the web also embodies a dark side. So not only progressive, democratic, inclusive movements arise thanks to the web, but there is also a dark side. No? And this dark side is exactly what did interested me. The interest I had from the very beginning, and therefore I started to look at the radical right movement on the web. And so I started several projects. So for instance, one then I've been publishing a book was exactly titled "The Dark Side of the Web," in which I started to collect information on all the extreme right groups in several European countries and United States with a presence online. So all the extreme right groups with a website, running a website. I know today can be a bit funny because websites are quite old. Today other arenas are arenas for mobilization, like social media, like. But some years ago, the websites were more or less one of the main arena where to start something politically. And I started to look at the use of the web by extreme right in several European countries and the US in order to do what? To do politics by other means. So in order to accomplish several functions of politics, which can be recruitment, mobilization, fundraising, political education, education, diffusion of propaganda and ideas. And this was a comparative research, so I didn't work by myself. Of course, I had many people working with me. And we mapped, we did these maps, which included any kind of radical right groups in these seven European countries. Portugal, unfortunately, was not there. There was Spain. So we somehow have been able to map between 100 and 200 websites of the radical right in each country. In the United States, there were more than 1,000. And we are talking about some years ago. The book was published in 2015. So, and then what we did was to reconstruct, on the one hand, the networks among these websites. So the way through which these websites are also used by this organization to construct virtual communities, national, but also international. And therefore we tried, we started also to trace the linkages between one website on the radical right to another in various countries, so across borders and also across regions between Europe and the US. And we discovered very, very important things. For instance, one thing that we discovered was that the structure of these virtual communities online, so if you analyze all these linkages with some techniques, like one I like very much is social network analysis, but you analyze and you try to understand the not only the composition of these networks, but also who are the peripheral actors, who are the central ones, who play a role of brokers, so put together in contact a sector of a movement which otherwise would remain separated. And so if you study this, you also understand something more about the offline reality of these social movement on the radical, this sector. So what we discovered was that, first of all, the way they organize online to each other is quite similar to the structures of these communities outside. And of course, for us, it was also a nice discovery, because sometimes extreme right groups, especially the most violent ones, are difficult to be reached with my usual instruments of analysis, like interviews, and therefore having on the web something that can appear a proxy, at least in a systemic view, of the offline reality was already a good achievement. Also because we could realize, for instance, potential line of conflict, cleavages, but also we could realize which were the most important actors in these groups, in these sectors, that not by chance then, after some years, became like the most important party of the country. So we could realize some dynamics on the web that actually then became true outside of the web. And so this is also the second point, you know, I have for us, if you want, as a reflection. So in how far we can understand like the radical right only remaining focused on political parties. Now, also today we talked about that. How can we explain radical right electoral success in the various countries? And today we have a lot of examples. Sometimes the economic explanations are good. Other times, no, the economic explanations are not enough. Because how can you explain, for instance, one typical explanation we have in electoral studies is that marginality, no? Peripherality, in socio-economic terms, is the reason why people vote on the extreme right. However, if you buy this hypothesis, how can you explain the success of the radical right in the very rich and healthy Northern European countries? Denmark, Sweden, and they are increasingly countries in which the radical right is strong. So you can adopt the more the cultural perspective, thinking about the voters of the radical right as the losers of the globalization and therefore processes of migration. So they vote for these parties because, culturally speaking, they are considered more able to defend an identity which is threatened by processes of globalization. Yeah, this can hold true in some countries, or in some regions, but not in others. And many other explanations. And so what I argue is that you cannot understand also this kind of electoral success and parties only focusing on political parties, but you have also to focus on the broader milieu. Now, as we said before, thank you, you have to focus on the social movements, you have to focus on the web, on the communication, on the political communication, also on the cultural communication. Recently, I published this book just a few months ago, which is about pop music and populism. So pop music and populism. And when this group of research contacted me, I am a specialist also on populism, of course, coming from the radical right interest. More recently, the radical right did marry with populism very often. Therefore, I have been asked several times to say something on this right-wing populism. And I was contacted by this group of research composed by musicologists. At the beginning, I thought, okay, but what do they want from me? Now I'm a political scientist, I don't know anything about music. And they proposed to me this funny project in between cultural studies, musicological studies, and political science, and I had to play the role of the political scientist, about pop music and populism in several European countries. And the idea at the basis of this project, which has been then implemented in several data collection ways, the basic idea was that, well, again, populism can be explained with structural factors, economic, political, but what about the production and reproduction of populism and the populist ideas through some more symbolic, cultural tools? Like it can be popular culture, which in a country can be equated also with pop music. No? For pop music, I mean like in Italy, Sanremo Festival. And analyzing the pop music in the last 20 years, in some countries where populism is particularly successful, like Italy, actually we realize that for many reasons, not necessarily consciously, not consciously, singers adopted populist like ideas or tropes, or frames or schemes of thinking, but we realize that that can be made a sort of overlapping sometimes on some ideas like anti-elitist, the idea of the individual achievement of success instead of collective achievement, something that the music of the 17th and 16th and 17th never would have neither referred to, no? The collective achievement, the collective movement was in theory proposed as a tool for changing society. No? And so we realized that understanding populism in a more subtle way, also we realized that yes, there can be a connection between pop music and popular culture and populism. In Sweden we realized, for instance, that the usage of pop material, including music, but also, as I said this morning, colors, pink, instead of dark. So there has been in Sweden what we can call a sort of popification of the radical right. So the radical right in Sweden has been able to be so successful recently, also because they started to become more pop in the color, in the music. In the colors, I mean, of the logos or the kioscos during political events. So pink, appealing, something not dangerous, not scary. And the same can be said for the music, which has been, which follows, the political events and so on and so forth. So this is another idea that I can launch here. So how can we use also a broader understanding of radical right, but also how can we explain with a broader view, no, the current success. So not just limiting to the shortcut solutions like poverty, radical right, low education, radical right. This doesn't hold true, not across countries, not across time now anymore. And so we need something more to explain the endurance, the development, the success, the penetration, the social penetration, the normalization, the mainstreaming. Ecco, so this is what I also am trying to study increasingly now.
And I just stop here. I stopped a lot.
To try to answer, but more the answer to articulate my thinking on this. I can start by the questions concerning my research and my ethnography with the radical right, which is more personal, so I can give you some also stories. First of all, I want to say that before studying the radical right, also from a qualitative perspective, and therefore with methods that put me quite close to these groups, I did a Marie Curie, which is a fellowship, an European fellowship, on disengagement from terrorism. So I was studying actually two different types of terrorism and terrorist groups. On the one hand, the ethno-nationalist one in the Basque country, and on the other hand, the left-wing terrorism of the 17th in Italy. So it happened to me to interview former terrorists of the left, so political area I'm close with. However, they have been terrorists. So in principle, they used violence as a legitimate means of political action. Which can also be normative challenging, no? As talking with a radical right, activist who thinks that it can be legitimate to attack physically a migrant, no? And so this was my first experience with my positionality, because it happened to me too. I did around 10 interviews in Italy, but with serious former terrorists, not people who have spent 20 years already in prison and now they are out. So, for instance, one was Bonisoli, who was participating to the, I don't know in English, excuse me, another word that doesn't come to me, rapimento di Aldo Moro.
Kidnapping.
So, kidnapping. So Bonisoli was part of the group, and I was interviewing him for 3 hours. So exhausting. So if I have to describe the main feeling of these interviews, were exhausting for me. Exactly, because I tried to put myself from the very beginning in the shoes of the others. So I didn't want to impose my categories, nor normative, neither analytical. I wanted really to understand the view of the world of the political actors, the agents in that moment, and therefore understand their political behavior according to their view, to their... And so the exhausting is the first characteristic. Then, of course, there are also problems of safety, because it happened then to me when I studied the radical right, for instance, to receive some threats. Some of them were also a bit funny, because, for instance, I was doing these interviews with radical right groups, so at the collective level, no, because when you interview activists, you work at the individual level, so it is already a bit more dangerous, let's say, because you really are close to activists. When you work at the mass organizational level, you interview the spokesperson, the representative. So for one party, it could be, for instance, Marine Le Pen, or so at least it is the representative. Although when you change the type of group, one thing is to understand to interview the representative of a radical right political party. Another, of course, situation is to interview a representative or leader of a neo-Nazi group, no, or a skinhead. So the degree of informality also poses more challenges and threats, not to you as a researcher. No, it happens to me to receive threats because at one point we were doing all these interviews together with some collaborators, and at one point a colleague from England called me, I was in Vienna, and said to me, Manuela, ma do you know that you are more or less on the all the most important web pages of extreme right groups in UK, because there is a sort of alert, don't answer to this group of research, they are communist, paid by the US government, insomma all the conspiracy theory ideas. And at that point, there was a problem also in terms of data protection, also personal protection, involvement of my department, because actually the department was sponsoring my research. So, what I can say is in these terms. On the one hand, there is the problem of positionality, and so how do you locate yourself, no? when you study topics and or groups? I don't want to say that you don't like, but at least that challenge you, your norms, your values. On the other hand, there is the problem of data protection, and today, honestly, there is probably more awareness also of social science in terms of all the steps that we have to do, for instance, the ethical, so all the ethical steps, like the informed consent, the storage of the data in a particular time, way. So before, we were a bit more unconscious, in my view, unconscious thinkers and researchers. Today, also the European Union, in order to give you research funds, you know, they impose correctly to you some ethical steps, and therefore also the safety arrangements, I would say, no? But would allow you also, in case, to study terrorist groups, radical right, left-wing, anarchist, everyone, and you might like them or not. And then, for instance, one ethical guideline is always to say the truth, or better, never to tell the lies. So you have to always, when you start an interview, a first contact, to say who are you, why you are studying this topic, what is your sponsoring institution. You cannot tell lies. At the same time, a good rule is, in social, really proper among the ethical rules, is not to show yourself more than it is enough for the interview. So not to discover facts or information about you, which are not important for the interview or the focus group at stake. Recently, to be honest, also happened to me to be more more in trouble to do interviews by myself, because now I start to be known. No, I published a lot, so 10 years ago, 15 years ago, even if you googled my name, you could find something. Today you can find more. And therefore I have started to have problem in penetrating radical right environments today. So for instance, during the COVID, I started a little project about the Novax movement, in particular the link between the radical right and the Novax. No, you know, in Italy has been one country which also experienced a violent attack, no? Of during this Novax protest by one group of the radical right against unions. And the idea was to compare the radical right and the Novax movement penetration, so the radical right and the Novax movement in several countries. And in Italy, for instance, it was impossible for me to do personally the interviews, but I needed to have collaborators, younger and men. Mostly, so I, as woman, as a scientist, because as you know, today the radical right, but also especially at the this peculiar nexus between radical right and Novax, also was characterized by anti-intellectualism. And therefore me, as professor, as woman, and so I have this problem, gender, because of course usually they are conservative environment, I wrote already too much on the radical right, so it is clear that I also have a location, so it is clear that in my thing, right, in my works, I also appear as at least, even if neutral, someone who wants to know, not probably too much. And therefore, for instance, today, for me, it's quite impossible to continue to study radical right if I don't have collaborators. Usually young collaborators are better able than me, they are
it would be possible for me, so to penetrate environments of the radical right in Italy. So for instance, on this research on the radical right in Novax, I did 25 interviews with the most important activists and founders of radical right Novax movement in Italy, like Forza Nuova, Ecco Castellitto, which was Castellitto, the leader that then was in jail because of the attack, was interviewed by our group a few days before. So these 25 interviews have been conducted by Nikolaos Saridakis, who I thank, who is a Greek guy, very, very much interested in the radical right, and he was much more able than me, in terms of language and also person, because he was a man, and the approach of these groups also very often is made in an informal way through attending like gyms where they perhaps do sport, you know, because there is also, at least in Italy, this sort of past fascist heritage, you know, of connection between sports and radical right, or cultural events, but usually all these situations are very machist also level, you know, as imprinting, and so also women that, which is not part of the group, would be immediately identified as strange there. So this just to answer to you. And then, no, all the other important things. International cyber community of the radical right, absolutely. In this Outlib project, no, Neo-Authoritarianism in Europe, which I now conduct for 3 years, we are looking exactly at the transnationalization of the radical right, not only online. And so the data that I illustrated this morning were talking about a possible cyber community across borders, no? So radical right groups which communicate to each other across borders through websites or I like in a Facebook, but these are quite also light transnationalization. But now what we see is that the radical right is transnationalizing slowly, but progressively, also offline. So they are connecting organizations, doing some events together, and also this is a trend which is, in my view, is will be increasing. I had this intuition also many years ago, saying I had this idea that the times in which the radical right was also constrained within the national boundaries because of nationalism were out. So also the radical right, also this kind of organization, were realizing that we can be united against Europe, but united. So not anymore single, because you know, also at the European Parliament level, the radical right had many problems, no? Many years ago in creating European groupings. There was this anecdote of the Alessandro Mussolini, leader of one important radical right party in Italy, that in this effort, no, of the radical group at European level formed, it was 2004, together with the Romanian radical right party, some of Eastern Central European countries' radical right parties, at one point they started to fight with each other because of typical nationalist view. So the Mussolini, Alessandro Mussolini, was attacking the, for instance, the radical right party from Romania with anti-immigrant typical narratives and phrases, which was paradoxical because, but at that time they were still fighting with these core values of nationalism. And currently, this trend is changing also. So we will try to understand that better also this move. About the media, ecco sì, what does influence what? Politics, culture, politics, culture. This is, I really think it's a sort of circular and dynamic process, because also in this research about pop music and populism, what we saw was really sometimes an endorsement, for instance, so an intervention of politics in the pop music scene. So like Di Maio, the leader of Lega, commenting on the victory of in Sanremo, so why you have to intervene? Because you are also using this popular music situation to say something political, actually. But also the other way around. We are also, we had some experience of pop music artists endorsing this and that populist parties in Italy, Five Star Movement instead of... So I really think it's a circular process. And then about the mainstreamization of the radical right. So what can be the linkages between the radical right and mainstream parties, or even better, what does produce the mainstreamization of the radical right, normalization? Are the mainstream parties partly responsible? Well, what has been seen, especially in studies focusing on content analysis, for instance, content analysis of party manifestos, it has been seen that, or content analysis on leader speeches, that also center-right and center-left, even center-left political parties, mainstreams, are influenced in their political discourse by a radical right party which become increasingly important. So somehow they also, I cannot say radicalize their view, but for sure they normalize in the political language, the mainstream ones, some ideas, some also vocabulary which would have been not accepted some years before. So even in Italy, this securitarian approach to immigration, for instance, which has been part of the radical right, of course, approach, then became slowly part of the radical, cioè fully the radical right, the approach of the Northern League, but then also influenced the way the Democratic Party was talking about immigration, which is incredible. Hmm? This securitarization approach. So of course it's true, because also then the language and the political discourse of the elites, mainstream, opens what this morning we were saying, we were calling discursive opportunities, no? So for discursive opportunities structure in sociology, we mean the discursive structure in a country, the discourses, which somehow set what is legitimate, what is not legitimate. And therefore, there are some discursive opportunities, usually fostered by the elites, by opinion leaders, which can really legitimate some ideas, some words that in other times would have been also legitimate. Mm? And so for sure, yeah, this is a relationship between the radicals and the mainstream parties is to be taken into account for reflecting on a normalization of the extremes like in 10 years. So I don't think the victory, for instance, in Italy of Giorgio Meloni with Fratelli d'Italia is out of the blue, and is something that can be explained just thinking about the last few years. It has been a trend of normalization of the radical right in Italy, radical right parties, since 1994. When the Alleanza Nazionale entered Berlusconi government, the normalization of some discourses, the and so on and so forth, and then culture also helps a lot. Then there are the economic crisis, which also helps, but and also then the 2015, the immigration waves, more currently the COVID also exacerbated some tensions in society. But in Italy, for instance, I see the victory of the radical right today as an outcome which comes from a long time, like from at least 10-15 years ago.
legitimate political actor. No?
And in Spain, when Vox started, it was clear that some ideas, some claims coming from society were not probably enough understood from the institutional referent at that time, and therefore Vox could find a space also in terms of bringing to the electoral system some ideas and values and demands which were already in society. So this brings us to the dramatic dilemma of today, no? Is it the radical right winning because there are already some ideas in society, some needs, no? Which then are capitalized on by one kind, by one organization, or is it winning because they create?
And do you think that
some ideas and some, you know, some needs? Again, I think it's a circular process. I remember when I was, all my interviews, one of these neo-Nazi activists or representative from the US told me, we don't entertain with music, you know, with our extreme right music, far right, we don't just entertain, so non divertiamo i neo-Nazis, no? Ma we create them, we form them. So it means, even with music, with a concert that we do, we are somehow nurturing a certain milieu, some ideas, also with the body, eh? So think about the sociology of bodies, no? So everything really is there, making the mix. So I remember clearly this sentence, no? We don't just entertain with our music Nazis, but we grow up them. Wow.
Yeah. I wanted to ask about the cordon sanitaire. Do you think that it works or it favors the right? I mean, sometimes it seems that if you hide it, then it explodes more, and then you don't know, you never have all the media aligned to that, so you always have.
Then we close, but this question poses the same normative dilemma that I wanted to raise, but then I forgot, concerning the hate speeches or radical right on the web. Should we impose some limits? So, freedom of speech or hate speech? So it means, who can decide what are the consequences of posing some limits, for instance, about the content which can be transmitted through the web? So if I'm an extreme right group, Am I legitimated to express my views on the web as another citizen of this democracy can do? And where are the boundaries? So if I am limited, do I risk to be even more too radicalized, even more myself, using the so stigmatization frame, you know, I am a victim? Or a democracy needs to, has the responsibility to, at one point, to pose some limits? Just two information, but you know probably better than me. The American Constitution and the American thinking, but they didn't experience fascism and Nazism, they give priority to the individuals over the society. So also the Constitution, not the First Amendments, are supporting the rights of freedom of association and freedom of speech. So you can say everything you want, more or less, no? And because this is democracy. The European democracies after the Second World War usually had a different approach, giving more prevalence to the collectivity over the individuals. So the collectivity has the responsibility to pose some limits, no? To the individuals, on the behalf and for the God, for the collective God of the collectivity. And indeed, in our constitutions and laws, we find some limits to, we find a regulation of on hate speeches, we find a regulation of, for more or less, on extremist websites, on the reconstruction of fascist parties, although today it seems to me that it is quite normalized. But I mean, it's a different approach. So when you say what we can expect, a cordon sanitaire, of course, can
can radicalize, but also, institutionally speaking, can impose some limits which hamper some political actors to be visible and therefore to spread a bit less than they could do their ideas as legitimate, their speeches as legitimate, although with the internet also this imposition of limits then is a bit more weaker, because again you can also not to participate to election but be visible and impose yourself as an opinion leader. So as you can see, all these topics are very problematic.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you so much for your passionate conversation with us on such an interesting topic and such interesting insights. And thank you all for joining us in this evening on Friday night. I hope you have a lovely weekend, and I'll see you in the next MPOP debate series in a couple of weeks. Okay, thank you so much.